There are four additional documents that you may end up constructing as you go through this process. So these are the ones we're going to talk about. The reference list you want to make sure is formatted stylistically in the same way as your other marketing materials, your resume, your cover letter. So save, you will see in the sample, the top portion of the document is matching the resume and the cover letters, basically. So let me show you the example. You can see from here all the way down to the word references. Everything that's above the word references is showing up on the resume and cover letter. So just copy, because remember, sometimes these pieces will get changed. So make sure you're copying directly from the documents that you're submitting so that you don't have slight changes in these. Put the word references, list the person name, their relationship to you, and what their role is, organization. You don't need to put their physical address, but it is helpful to include where they're located just for time zone purposes if somebody decides to pick up the phone and call them. Usually that's what'll happen is they'll either get a phone call or more likely an email, quite often a survey that they just go online to fill out. So the most important thing is the email. But you should include a phone, and if other information is specified, then for sure include that. Sometimes you won't even need to create this document because you will just enter it into an applicant tracking system. This is if you do need to have it as an attachment or a document, and make sure that you save it as a PDF to preserve the formatting and to mask any changes that you have made to the document. You can have up to six people. That's a little bit much, but sometimes you can make a good case for why, and so then in that case, you should put it in two columns. But you should always have a minimum of three and follow what it is that they specify. Usually they'll say three professional references. And only submit this when it is requested. So you should have it available, but not supply it until it is asked. Thank you notes. Basically, you really just want to say, so glad I had the opportunity to meet with you. It's good to specify something about the interview or the person that you're writing to so that it's clear that you've customized it, that you've taken the time to customize it. If you make it super bland and generic, it's kind of, I mean, it's better than not doing it, but you can just make such a bigger impact if you customized it. And specify your continued interest in the position. And you'll see that in the sample that's included with this lesson. But keep it short. They are not interested in reading a huge amount of information. And you can call them by their first name if they introduced themselves that way, but it's better to err on the side of formality. But go with industry standards. Like in tech, you're probably going to be using first names, but if you do something like in higher education, probably going to be using doctor, whoever. So if you meet with a panel of people or several different people through the day, the minimum you should be doing is the head of the search committee. But the best thing that you can do is every single person you met with personalized. So take the time, it can make a real difference. Do it immediately within one business day of your interview. If they say, oh, we're not going to get to this, the search committee isn't going to meet until, after the middle of the month because somebody's out of town, and then you can do a handwritten note and you think it will be appropriate and fitting and will make a good impression, do that. But in general, email is going to be your best bet. So take a look at the samples so that you can have some idea of how to customize and what to include. Now, a bio. It is rare that people need to create a bio. Generally, this is only done for C-suite executive level competitions, and they are requested. So only supply it if it's requested. Write it in the third person. It's a very formal document. You should include a photo. It's really basically you're summarizing your resume and hitting the key points. But you still want to be attentive to your formatting and make sure that it's consistent with your other marketing materials and include highlights. You'll see that in the sample. So take a look at that just to get an idea of style and how to make sure that you are not making it this dense block of text that nobody will ever read. A pitch letter. Now this, it's unlikely that you will ever write this, but if you do, it, really what it is it's sent to an organization when there is not a specific job posting, but you feel like, this is the place for me. I just want to get in the door. I just want to have a conversation. And I have something to say. It's going to be clear that I can contribute. So you'll see this particular pain letter, this term here, which is developed by a career coach named Liz Ryan. This is a hot link. So click on that and you'll get some more information and background about what should be in the pain letter and how to write it. And the reason she calls it a pain letter is because you're essentially trying to assess what is it that is causing this organization pain? What is the unmet need that they have, maybe that they're not even aware of? And you write the letter specifically to that. So it's because it's so rarely used, it's a card that you can play if you feel like this is an extraordinary fit for me and I can't wait for something to be posted. I want to forge a conversation with people. Truthfully, networking is probably going to be a better entry point for you, but I just want you to know about this as an option. Make sure that you get your point across without having to write this massive amount. And you will see that in the sample. So take a look at that to get an idea of the length. So make sure, the thing that you're going to end up doing here is doing a reference page. So make sure that you are contacting the people that you want to list, asking their permission. Ask them what kind of support they want, if they would like a copy of your resume, if they would like you to email them after you have an interview to give them the key and distill the key points that they might want to convey and alert them to potential landmines that they might want to skirt and give them ideas about that. So offer that as an option, but remember, they are counting on you for being brief. You do not want to write them this massive document that's going to just consume their time. Distill information. Also ask them, would you prefer that I use your cell phone or your business line or your personal email or your business email? So ask them what kind of contact info they want you to list, what's best for them. And then these other documents may come up, particularly the thank you notes, but you don't really have to do any preparation for them until they're right there on your radar.